Okay, so how is everyone today? Good, I hope. Okay, so first announcement is that it appears that after all, the testing center is not going to be able to conduct quiz 13. So that's good news and bad news. So maybe good news because, well, maybe you didn't want to take quiz 13 this week anyhow. Okay, so there you have it. What it actually means is that quiz 13 is going to move from the optional redo portion to the mandatory portion. So the mandatory portion is going to be slightly longer, and the redo portion of the final exam is going to be slightly shorter. But altogether, you should have plenty of time because it's 165 minutes. And I'll post the key to quiz 13, which was never meant to be, I suppose. Any questions about any of that? Okay, so then last time we were talking about interest, money interest. So there's two styles. The first style that we talked about was something like where we said, okay, well, I'm a bank now, and you can make a deposit to me, and I'll pay you interest because I'm using your money to do whatever it is that I'm doing. And the way the interest works is I'll make a payment to you by sending you a check in the mail. So maybe something like, you're letting me hold and use your $100, and I send you a $3 check every month. Okay. And notably, your account balance, I'm not putting it into your account. I'm just sending you a check. And you're not allowed to make any more deposits. So it's always 100. Such an interest scenario is referred to as simple interest. A more interesting scenario is when I'm still reckoning interest, but instead of sending you a check in the mail, what do I do with an interest check in the mail? What do I do with it instead? I put it back in your account. Now this is more interesting because if we were to proceed in this way, then after the first month, for 1 month, you'd have $100, and then I reckon interest on that $100. I'll deposit $3. Now you have $103, and so now I'm going to reckon interest not on for the next month. I'm going to reckon interest not against 100 but against 103. So that means that you'll get $3 and a few cents. You'll get a little more than $3, and then deposit that in, and then your new account balance will be around 106. Okay, so compound interest is when the interest payment is not routed to you and away from the account, but rather routed back into the account. So compound interest works in that way. So here it is. This is referred to as the discrete compound interest formula. So the discrete compound interest formula has five parameters. So A, this is the account balance at time T. So specifically, we're talking about an account whose balance is changing in time. P, this is the principal. And what that means is that it is the account balance at a specific time. At what specific time?
Zero.
So in either case, when you're making a savings, say you purchase something for the purpose of savings, the amount that you put down, that's called the principal. And it also works the other way. If you take out a loan, then the amount at the initial amount that you owe at time zero is the principal.
R, this is the periodic interest rate.
And in essentially all the scenarios we're going to deal with and the majority of scenarios that you'll ever deal with, one period is 1 year. So you'll have a yearly interest rate. A synonym for the adjective yearly is annual.
Okay. Then there's N. This is the number of compoundings per period.
Okay, so that requires a little bit of explanation. So, typical scenario might be something like the following. You might have a savings account at a bank, and they say that you have, since this is imagination, let's go fully for it. Let's say you have a 36% annual interest rate savings account. By the way, if you have one of those, you shouldn't even be here. You should just go sell all your stuff and put every bit of it in that account. That's what you should be doing.
Okay, so
36% annual interest rate. But that doesn't mean that they're gonna at the end of 1 year they're gonna put 36% in. What actually happens in real life is that interest is compounded monthly, usually, in the majority of cases. That means that every month, how much are they going to assess if your yearly rate is 36%? Three. And how did you come up with 3%? 36 divided by 12. So that means that every month they're going to give you 3%. Okay, so then when you see it say monthly, that means that N is 12. When you see it say weekly, what does that mean?
Fifty-two.
Right, and then I'll try not to use any adjectives and other words that are strange. Like I could say furlongly. How long is a furlong? Or no, a furlong is a distance. How long is a fortnight? Fortnightly. That's 2 weeks, right? So how many fortnights in a year? 26. Forget it. We're not gonna do that. Okay. I'll try and stick to things that are obvious.
Okay. Then T is the number of periods, and in almost all cases, that means the number of years. Those are the parameters. There are five of them. Here is the model. The model is this equation that you must memorize. A is P multiplied by 1 plus R divided by N raised to exponent NT.
So that's a formula that you must memorize. There's five parameters in that model. But now, I want to explain why it's got to be this, and why this model, Gesundheit, this model makes sense.
So why is it like this?
Well, let's run with that example. So I selected the number 36%. That's totally unrealistic, but 36 is divisible by 12, so That makes the numbers nice. So, let's suppose
that you make a deposit of 1,000 into a 36% annual interest rate account, which is compounded monthly.
So that means that how much are they going to deposit in every month? So if it's 36 annual and they're doing it monthly, how much will they deposit per month in percent? 3%. They'll do 3%. So for the first month, if your account balance is 1,000, at the end of the month, they'll do 3%. What is 3% of 1,000? $30. So that means that they're going to put 30 into your account. So then what will your new account balance be? 1,030, right? So it's going to be 1,030. And the way I want you to think about it is that at the end of 1 month, after interest is reckoned, you'll have 100% of what you already had. You'll have 1,000. And then you'll also have 3% of what you had. So at the end of 1 month, you have 103% of what you formerly had.
So that means that at the end of 1 month, at the end of 1 month, your account balance is 1,000 multiplied by,
well, how do you represent 103% as a decimal? What is it?
1.03.
So we should be able to type that into the calculator and get 1,030.
So that's 1,030.
Well then, at the end of two months,
we would have done that twice.
Which is to say that if I'm covering up the amount of money that we had for the duration of the second month, then the way that we get the new account balance is multiplying by 103%. So what do I need to multiply by?
1.03.
So that is, I need to multiply that number by 1.03. But that number is that number, right? So that's 1,000 times 1.03 squared.
And my calculator is saying that that's $1,060.90.
What about at the end of the third month? That means we need to take this number and multiply by what? 1.03. But after all, that is 1,000 multiplied by 1.03 multiplied by 1.03 multiplied by 1.03, right?
Which is to say, we should do 1,000 times 1.03 with exponent 3. My calculator is saying that this number is 1092.73, rounding to the nearest cent.
Okay, so what I'm saying is that this was at the end of 1 month.
This was at the end of 2 months. This was at the end of 3 months.
Now I have a question for you. Suppose that we fast forward, and I want you to tell me
What would the account balance be after 2.5 years? So what's the account balance now?
So, for 1 month we needed one of those. For 2 months we needed two of them. For 3 months we needed three of them. How many will we need for 2.5 years? 30 of them, right? And how did you get 30? 12 times 2.5, right? 12 times 2.5. 12, 2.5. So 30. 30 is what we need. Now I could write 1.03 30 times. What a task that would be.
Rather, I'll write 1,000 times 1.03 to 30. And then just type that into the calculator. My calculator says 2427.26.
The reason why we're using 30 is because 30
is 12 multiplied by 2.5.
So what I'm telling you is that in this consideration, this number right here that I'm obscuring right here in this problem is 1.03. 1.03. What's this number? What's the symbolic name for this number? It's P, right? This one is P, the principal. And then NT is 30. That's why this formula must look this way. So the way an interest-bearing account works is that you get this month's balance from the previous month's balance by multiplying it by some factor. And it's never in your life going to be 1.03. It'll be more like 1.0004 or something like that. Okay. Good. So let's have one of these. Let's do one of these.
So for example, I could say, which do you prefer? Do you prefer the scenario where you deposit $1,000 into a, say, 3.1% annual interest rate account, which is compounded monthly, and then we're going to do this for 6 years. So that's one scenario. The second scenario is, how about we'll deposit the same amount of money into 3.18% annual interest rate account, and this time we're going to compound it quarterly. And we're going to do this for 6 years.
So that is that I've given you two scenarios. One of them has a lower interest rate but more frequent compoundings. And the other one has a higher interest rate but a lower frequency of compoundings. And I'm making an assumption here, which is a widely held assumption, but let's make it explicit. And that is, I am assuming that your preference is to have more money rather than less. Okay. So, how do you answer the question then? Well, there's two scenarios, right? Which means I want you to run the model twice. Once for scenario one, and then again for scenario two. And I want you to select whichever one has more money. That's what I want. So how many parameters are in the model? Five. And if you're going to do it, if you're going to run the model, I necessarily must have given you all but one parameter. So how many parameters must I have given you? Four. From each one of these stories, you need to be able to extract four parameters.
So in scenario one, I see a number. What parameter does that correspond to? P, right? P is 1,000. That is to say that when the clock starts at time zero, there's $1,000. Okay, now I see another number. What number is this? Which number does this represent? R. And what is the numeric value of R? So is it 3.1? Right, 0.031. Because you take, to convert a percentage to a decimal, you move the place two positions to the left. Or, if you like, you divide by 100. Okay. What else do we know? N, okay. In scenario one, what is N? 12. Why is it 12? Right, because it says annual, the period is annual, and the frequency is monthly. So there's so there's 12 of them. Okay, and then what's this 6? That's T, right? So, we were given four parameters. Which one were we not given? A. Notably, that's the one that we want, right? Because that's telling us how much money we'll have. Okay. So that means that we need to do A is 1,000 multiplied by 1 plus 0.031 divided by 12 raised to exponent 12 times 6. So see if you can get your calculator to do this, because you'll need to do it under pressure. So for my calculator at least, that is to say that kind of calculator, the sequence of button mashes is this. 1,000 times 1 plus 0.031 divide 12, and then caret 12 times 6. That's what I have to type into my calculator. Okay. So, I'm getting 1204.13. Any question about that? So, have we answered the question then?
No, right? What we've done is we've run the model once, and we've come to the conclusion that if we select scenario 1, at the end of scenario 1, we'll have $1,204.13. Now the question is, well, what if we select scenario 2?
Will we have more or less money in that circumstance? Okay. Well, still the principal is 1,000. What's the interest rate now? Almost the same as it was before, right? I just tacked one more 8 on the end there. So a little bit higher interest rate. What is N? 4. Quarterly means that we're doing it 4 times a year. And then we're still doing it for 6 years. So into the calculator now, I need to type 1001 plus 0.0318, divide this by 4, raised to 4 times 6.
Okay.
So 1209.30.
So what do we prefer? We prefer the second one.
Prefer the second one.
So generally speaking, if all other things are held equal, you want a higher interest rate if it's your money to be deposited. Similarly, all other things being equal, you want more compoundings. So if they say you can have all these things and you can select either quarterly or monthly, you should select monthly. Monthly will be better if everything else is the same. If they say monthly or weekly, then choose weekly. If they say weekly or daily, choose daily. Daily will be better. So what this question is addressing is that, well, it's sort of like a race, a contest. Who won in this particular race? I made this one have a higher interest rate but a lower number of compoundings than the other one. And as it happened on this particular example, the higher interest rate won. But if I had made the number of compoundings for this one smaller, or these one a little bit higher, then it might have been, or if I had made these one higher or these ones lower, it might have been a different scenario. Okay. So let's run with that. How far can we take this argument of playing with the number of compoundings and things like this? So let's consider the discrete compound interest formula. Compound interest model. A is P multiplied by 1 plus R over N to NT. And to simplify matters a little bit, let's consider the scenario when P is 1, R is 1, and T is 1. So now that's a little bit abstract. Let's work through this and understand what hypothetical scenario I'm talking about. So P is 1. So let's say that I'm now a bank. I'm a bank. And you're allowed to make deposits and you're allowed to make a deposit of exactly $1. So I won't accept any more or less than a $1 deposit. And then R is 1. What does that mean about the interest rate? 100%. That's good, right? And then T is 1. That means that, and I'm allowing you to hold this account for 1 year. So that's what it means. So you're allowed to make a $1 deposit. It's 100% interest, and it's going to be active for 1 year. If we substitute these three values into that model, then A is still A, but what's the new right-hand side? Substituting in P is 1, R is 1, and T is 1. Well, since P is 1, I don't have to write it. Then it would be 1 plus 1 over n, since r is 1, raised to what exponent? N. So now let's think through this for a moment. If I'm a bank and you deposit a dollar with me and I offer 100% interest, but I'm just going to compound it once, that means that I'm going to hold your dollar for a year, and at the end of a year, I'm going to give you back that dollar, thank you for letting me use it, and I'm going to give you another dollar as your 100% interest. So I will be giving you back $2. Okay?
So I'm going to make a little table here. So we just reasoned that if there's one compounding, then your account balance at the end when I close the account is $2.
Now, does that agree with the formula that we have written there? That is to say, what if we were to do 1 plus 1 over 1 to exponent 1? 1 plus 1 over 1 raised to exponent 1. But can you see that? Okay, so if I type that, I should get 2, and I get 2. Okay, good. So what if we say, okay, no, not one compounding, we're going to do two compoundings. So at the end of 6 months now, I'm going to reckon interest on your $1. But I'm not going to reckon 100% interest since I'm doing it twice. What am I going to reckon interest? 50%, right? So what is 50% of a dollar? 50 cents. So at 6 months, at the end of 6 months, I deposit 50 cents. So now your account balance is $1.50. So for a further 6 months, your account balance is $1.50. Now I'm going to assess an interest of 50% on that. What is 50% of $1.50? 75 cents. And so then now I deposit 75 cents. What is your current account balance at the end of the account? 225. So that is to say, what do we get if we plug in n is 2? That we should get, 1 plus 1 over 2 to exponent 2. Well, we just reasoned it out in our head and said 225. So the calculator, if the universe is just, should write 225. Okay, 225. Good.
So at the end, if we do one compounding, it's $2. If we do two compoundings, it's $2.25.
So this is what I meant when I said to you, if all other things are held constant, more compoundings are better for you.
Okay. What if we do it monthly? That is to say, I'm going to skip down to what n value? 12. So if I skip down to 12, and I plug 12 into there, then what will I get? What would it be now? It would be $2.61.
Wow, I like this game. Right? More money, even better. So now here's the thought experiment. We want to ask ourselves, just how much money can we get out of this? If I was to say that I'm willing to open up a bank right now, and now you can deposit exactly $1, no more, no less, I'll give you 100% interest. and it's going to close after 1 year, and you're allowed to choose as many compoundings as you want. And you might say, could I do it every week? Sure. What would that, what N would correspond to that? 52. And then I say, of course you can. Could I do it every day? So what N value is that? 365? Okay, could I do it? And I'll say, yeah, of course. Could you do it every second? Sure, right? Because there's only 86,400 seconds in a day, right? So there's only a few million seconds in a year, a few hundred million or whatever. So my question to you is, how high can we get it to go? Can we get it over $5? Can we get it over $500? You know, because maybe we'll compound it every nanosecond. A nanosecond is an easy thing to say, but many people don't quite comprehend just how short a nanosecond is. What's the fastest thing in the universe?
Light.
Okay, and that's not just a good idea, it's the law, right? You're not going to travel faster than light. How far does a photon in free space travel in 1 nanosecond? About 10 inches. A nanosecond is a really short amount of time. if light is only able to travel less than a foot in that amount of time. Okay, so let's just make it, you know, for sake of argument.
Let's do a billion, right? One with 9 zeros behind it. That's more than the number of seconds in a year.
So I'm compounding it more than once a second. If I plug in a billion, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, that's me counting with zeros. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay. If I type this into the calculator, the rest of it's over there, right? What will the calculator give me? It's going to give me a smaller value than you might have thought, right?
It gives you 1.7128. And then 1.8, and then some other stuff.
And you will find that no matter how big of a number you put in, you're never going to get more than 2.71828. The other numbers past it will creep up a little bit, but you're never going to get more than that. Does anyone recognize that number?
What is this number? This is the natural number. Which we talked about on Monday, and what, just like pi, the circle constant is denoted by Greek letter pi, what is this one denoted by? E.
That is to say, in our hypothetical scenario where I allow you to deposit $1, I agree to give you 100% interest, and the account closes in 1 year, and I set it to you to tell me how many times you want me to compound, you will never get more than $8 from me. That is the maximum achievable. Okay.
So, as a result of that, we have the continuously compounding. Interest model. Is when you take the discrete interest model so the discrete compounding interest model and you let the number of compoundings, which is to say n, become infinite. The new formula is A is P exponential RT.
For various reasons that I think are obvious, this is frequently referred to as the PERT formula. Okay, now how many parameters are in this model? There's four, to which you might object and say, there's clearly five letters. I agree that there are five letters, but I still insist that there's just four parameters. Why? Because E is a constant. Okay. So, I could say something like,
what is the account balance of a 1, 2, 3, 4 deposit into a 2.37, or just 2.3 because that's what I wrote, 2.3% annual interest compounded continuously after 4 years.
Now, at this point, we have actually three interest models, three different ones. So what are they? What are the three possible models? So that's one of, there's one of them that has that in it. But even before that, the very, very first one. Simple.
So they're either simple, all of them can be categorized as simple or compounding. So what does simple mean?
Yeah, is that you get a check in the mail. And that interest payment is not going into the account. So they're either simple or compounding.
The simple one, the formula, is that the interest payment is PRT.
That's the check in the mail model. So for this particular exercise that we're working on, is it simple or compounding? And what is your signal that it is which one? So it's probably compounding, right?
Okay. Now that seems that may sound like a forced
thing, but I'll tell you that having taught this class a number of times, in 1 week, we're going to have an exam, and I'm going to write a question more or less just like this, and someone is going to use the simple interest formula. Unless I forcefully say something like this. Okay.
So then now, in the compounding formulas, there are two varieties. What varieties? Discrete and continuous.
So there's discrete. The formula for the discrete model is A is P times 1 plus R over N to NT. And then there's the continuous model, which is the PERT formula on the previous page.
Now, in this specific exercise, which one are we supposed to use and why? The continuous one, and what is your signal that it's the continuous one?
Probably the word continuous, right?
So if you see something like monthly or weekly or every second or something like that, that means the discrete one.
So does everyone see that there's three models and you have to be able to, proper using the story, properly select the one you're looking for? Okay.
So this is the one that we want. How many parameters are in this model? Four. So in order to be able to run this model, we need all but one. So we need to be able to extract how many parameters from the story? Three. So in particular, P is 1, 2, 3, 4. R is 0.023. And T is 4. Which means, which one were we not given? A. And you should always check, which one was I not given? We were not given A. And furthermore, does the story indicate that that is the one that we're looking for? It does, right? It says find the account balance. Okay, so A is 1, 2, 3, 4, exponential of 0.023 multiplied by 4. So see if you can get your calculator to do that. My calculator, the sequence of buttons, is 1, 2, 3, 4 times, and then e caret, 0.023 times 4. And then on my calculator, to get e caret to show up, I have to type second, and then a button called ln.
So on my calculator, there's the ln button. You can just see it barely, maybe. So second ln gives you the e caret. Okay, and my calculator
is giving, so 352.91. So I've made an error.
I've made an error in that I have not written down the correct number. So it's wrong in that way. But I claim that this is not just a little bit wrong, this is categorically wrong. If a student were to submit this as an answer, that would indicate to me that first off, they've made an arithmetic error, but more than that, they fundamentally misunderstand the entire point of the exercise. So can someone elaborate on why I might come to that conclusion? Exactly. So what was it? Right. This is a story about you made a deposit into an interest-bearing account. And to write this down is to say that as a result of making this deposit into an interest-bearing account, I now have approximately $900 less. You have fundamentally misunderstood the question. Okay?
So the real number on my calculator has that one there. Okay, so that's a
reasonable answer. Okay, so last thing.
And this is going to feel, perhaps, a little non sequitur. Here's an equation that I would like for you to solve.
Now the problem, the primary obstacle that we need to overcome is that we want to solve for x, but x is currently in a really awkward position. It's in the exponent. And we really don't want it to be there. We'd like it to not be in the exponent. So one way we can sort of smuggle x out of the exponent in the following sort of cute way. So notice that the left-hand side is written in exponential base 2, but the right-hand side is written in exponential base 16, reckoning this as being 16 to 1. Is it possible to write 16 in base 2?
Yes.
How? 2 to 4,
right? So then if we were to write 2 to 5x minus 3, equal 2 to 4. Now notice that they're both written in exponential base 2. But then what must be true about the exponents? Yeah, it must be the case that 5x minus 3 is equal to 4. So in that sort of cute way, we were able to get the variable out of the exponent. And now this is an equation you could have solved, I suspect, before you even got to college algebra. So 5x is 7, so x is 7 over 5. But now I want you to compare it to the following exercise, which we also need to be able to answer. So solve 2 to exponent 5x minus 3 is equal to, so far exactly the same as the previous one. But now I'm going to say equal to 17.
And now, well, it's not as cute as the previous one, is it? Which is to say, it's not easy to write 17 as exponential base 2. 2 to what? Something a little more than 4, right? But who knows what? So what we're going to do next time is we're going to figure out how to solve an exercise like this. Okay, so have a nice Wednesday.